this side all the time, and I'm speaking about equality, so why about places too? So I think I'm audible. Yes, so I would like to speak without a mic. Everybody's comfortable. I'm speaking about the study of gender roles in Indian television commercials from a feminist perspective. Since much of it is repeated, I would like to do away with the PPT. There are just one or two videos which I would like to play, so I'm saving time there. So I would like to cut short with the presentation. Let it be more of one-to-one discussion kind of thing, since ma'ams and candidate already has discussed much part of it. Let me start with, what do I mean when I say a feminist perspective? Rebecca West, who was a feminist, she said, I don't know why people call me a feminist. It's just that when I differentiate myself from a doormat or a prostitute, people think I'm a feminist. So I agree with what she says, because feminist is not about wearing a bun or a khadi kurta or certain images associated with womanhood. It's just equality. Feminism as a theory just promotes gender equality or both gender. It means that, ma'am, if I'm audible, I would like to of gender equality. It believes that nature or biologically there was no difference between man and woman. It was only society through its cultural constructs that differentiated between them and hence inhibited the growth of women. It was not a couple of years that we have evolved into this concept of feminism. It was a hard work of centuries. Initially, we were fighting for political power, that is the right to vote, till 1920s it is believed. In 1960s, we started for equality at workplace. 1990s was believed to be a phase where we were celebrating personal experiences, autobiographies of women. Some believe we have entered the fourth phase of feminism, which celebrates the fact that you can wear a lipstick, you can shave your legs, you can be married, and yet you will be a feminist. So you need not have those stereotypical images of feminist women in your mind. Now, my point is that when we see the Indian advertisement, where do you locate this feminism? I believe it is phase zero, because certain ads don't even come in the first wave of feminism. Let's take certain examples or a brief history of how advertising evolved. How many of we actually are aware that Horlicks came in 50s and it was supposed to be a cold chill drink taken with ice cubes? So it has, you know, a journey of almost a century for Indian advertising and marketing industry as well. From 60s swinger swing machine ads to 70s, which had the Will's ad on marketing campaign looking for a perfect couple where the man was smoking and the girl was some trophy standing by his side, to the 80s where we graduated into the colored ad, the coming of the Asiad Games, Mahabharat, Ramayan, saw people glued not only to the serials but also to the advertising. 90s saw the great economic reforms, MNCs entering into the markets, and hence there was a boom in the marketing industry. Some of pure genius ads were made out of rivalries. How many of us can forget the ads of Pepsi and Coca-Cola replying to each other in the ads? They were some kind of cult. And so were Pepsodent, Colgate, or Bonvita, Horlicks. But again, I'm not talking about the genius of the advertising industry. What I'm referring is to the feminist images. Some of us, ma'am, has already discussed. We generally can divide women when we look at the ads into three or four broad categories. We have discussed them. The traditional woman, she is supposed to be cooking breakfast. I don't know, she is some Devi or Amba with four hands, and one of the kids says upma, uttapam, all that she is cooking. Second act shows teenagers, there may be parents buying scooties for them. Third would be the men-based products, where the women are generally making those cheap kind of expression, googling or, you know, vying for attention. The fourth, which I am more bothered, and because nobody has touched that topic, I would like to elaborate that on, are the pseudo-feminist ads. I would like to put forward a question. How many of us have actually seen women in a four-wheeler ad, other than the side seat, or, you know, accompanying their husband to picnic trips? Now, go to the parking lot of our college. I think most of the faculties here drive cars, but none of the cars have women showing driving. And actually, there was a vehicle by the name of Mobilio, if you have seen the ad. They came out with the first ad where the woman was driving the car, and within a week, the ad was withdrawn from the market because they thought it would hurt the masculinity of the vehicle if the woman was supposed to be shown driving that car. Now, I'm ridiculed by the fact. Many of us are taxpayers here, but how many of the insurance companies are actually targeting women as potential policy buyers? Or let's move forward to the question of investing in mutual funds. Because, you know, they are supposed to be mathematical or a bit difficult topic, so the men will handle that. And we are also paying tax. Come on, be bothered about us. But they don't give a damn. let's take one more example of Airtel, and I would like sir to please move to the ad here. And if you've seen the ad, you can you know, tell me in between so that it saves a lot of time. Yes, this is ad. You can stop me in between if you've seen this ad. If you've seen the entire ad, for those of you who have not seen, I'll just give a brief. This woman, it's not revealed, is the wife of the subordinate. She goes home in a very chauffeur-driven car, and then it is shown that she's cooking and without the help of a maid. And after she's cooked the food, she gives a video call to her husband saying, "Oh God, the food is prepared and be on time. Tell your boss the wife is waiting." Now the question is, in most of this is a metro city they're depicting. In most of the households here, we have maids to help us out. Now, Mr. Jose, who was the head of the marketing and the creative agency who made this ad, he thought that the female members in his group would be very happy when this ad would come out. Instead, his mailbox was full of hate mails. He said, "My own staff was ridiculing me." He says, "As if you are reinstating the fact that at whatever post you work, maybe your boss in the office, go home, cook for me and wait for me. Now on certain days even I wait, but if I'm hungry, I don't wait for my husband at all. Am I approaching the time? I'm almost to the close of it." "Yes ma'am, I'm almost closing." See, the problem is that I know most of the ads, the companies, they're driven by market figures, as sir rightly pointed out yesterday. But we have to make sure that in depicting and portraying women, we are not taking a step backward from where we started, because then we are doing a great harm to our own earlier generations who worked a lot to achieve where we are today. Now in this context, I would just like to end with certain campaigns which have been started on social media. One which was strikingly good was Start With The Boys campaign. Now, it said, the ad was that, and I would just like to play two lines if time permits. It is, "Boys are not supposed to cry," because it shows from a very early age we teach them. And this was one ad because my young son, 3-year-old, he watches television and then he repeats certain lines. And he says, "Mama, boy, rote nahi hai." Manka, look at the end, rulate nahi hai, so don't make mama cry for you. So that was one thing which was good, and in making ads like this, we are doing a great service to womankind. And I'm not ashamed of the fact that we need support of the other gender also. So I would like to start with the boys, and the coming generation needs service. We have to raise our boys and girls, act even ma'am said. So I'd just like to play the last ad and come to a close with that. And in the background,
you
have girls who are smiling
at
the same time.
Stop crying, Robert. Are you a girl? Boys won't cry. Okay?
And see, you'll have a girl smiling who is going to school, but the boy is crying. See, she's smiling, but nobody is bothered. Okay?
बचपन से ही सिखाते हैं कि लड़के रोते नहीं हैं। शायद बेहतर होगा अगर हम सिखाएं कि लड़के रुलाते नहीं हैं।
So this was one thing. something which was striking to me.
Thank you so much, Shruti.
Abhishek, I see, since we are running short of time, and before I begin my presentation, I will request sir to run the video which I want to show.
Power and control are the reasons the rape happens in the first place. At least one in every three women have been beaten, coerced into sex, or otherwise abused in their lifetime. Domestic violence, child marriages, acid attacks, rape, violence against women is regrettably a global epidemic. But even in the toughest places, there are extraordinary women who are in the forefront of trying to bring about positive change.
Domestic violence, rapes, and sexual predation in most conflict countries like Sierra Leone are among the worst.
How do we get discouraged?
We want to see a civilian where women and girls are empowered to equally contribute, free from violence, whether it is physical or that is sexual. The rape centers themselves have been a big accomplishment by providing men and girls with free psychosocial support, medical treatment, and legal advocacy. We are giving women social empowerment. Men and women are starting to talk about the issues.
It is an abuse.
We need awareness programs, community actions, legal rights. These are crimes against human beings. They are crimes, and they need to be addressed.
Okay, I think the topic needs no introduction now. Portrayal of women was the most, from the morning we are listening to it. But what about these issues? Where do they get, from where they do come? The result is media. And how much do we participate? Ma'am said, it is not just enough to talk about these issues in our room, on our tablets, on our phones. No, we need to address them critically. And in order to do that, I just wanted to check the level of awareness and participation of women, since it was easier for me to get the sample from this university only. How much we are participating, especially since we are so-called digitally empowered. Isn't it? We all have tablets, we all have mobile phones, we all have internet, and we all have an account on our Facebook and Twitter. There were certain campaigns that are being run on the social media sites. I took up 5 campaigns that included Mustful, Mulk, My Body, My Soul, Asset Rehabilitation, and last but not the least, the most talked about, Selfie with Daughter. And to my surprise, the result were... Now, if I discuss them, you will be also surprised. Only 20% of the 100 samples that I took get to know about 2 campaigns, that is Selfie with Daughter, another was My Body, My Soul. Must, Mud, and the Asset Rehabilitation campaign, they were just unknown to the students as well as the working faculties over here. Most of them felt that Facebook, the posts which we get on Facebook are fake as compared to Twitter. Twitter, because of its privacy of settings, it was considered more reliable as compared to Facebook. Another thing that was surprising was none of the faculty members as well as the students, the sample which I collected, had participated in Selfie with Daughter campaign, the much talked about. 2 of the campaigns were very popular, as I said, was My Body, My Soul, Selfie with Daughter, and another was Mud, and that too because of the involvement of celebrities in it. See, the point here which I want to reflect is, although the information is spread to us, there are various channels, be it the traditional media, that includes your newspaper, television or radio, or be it the new media, that is the digital media. It is not just sufficient to talk about them and just to discuss it or share it or post it or like it. The much thing which we all have to do is critically analyze it, bring it to the public, and we as instead of crying or yelling that the government is not doing anything, the people are not doing anything, the police is not doing anything, no. It is you who have to come out, it is you who have to discuss it is you who have to take strong action and come out with these problems. Unless and until we take any step, no one is going to help us out. So this was one of the point which I made through my study. And I would just conclude it with the recent happening. We all, as we, I think most of us would have done. Recently when Narendra Modi visited US, he said that we should support Digital India. I have also supported Digital India by changing my profile picture into I support Digital India, which almost everybody would have, must have done. But instead of changing the profile picture or sharing it on iShare link, we should talk about the serious issues that are going in the society. That has to be done by us, and we have to actively play a role in it. Thank you.
Independent of women and media in Indian society. This paper attempts to analyze the role played by women in context of contemporary Indian society. It has been widely recognized that media can play an instrumental role bringing social transformation and social change. The attitude of the society gets revealed through the way subjects dealing with women are treated by media. Whether deliberately or unintentionally, the way women have been portrayed in media is an exaggerated form of real life circumstances and assumptions. It has a very little relation with real life. In the present era of cable, satellite, television has become a part of everybody's life in almost every level of socio-economic economic strata. Television series like Balika Vadhu, Punar Vimah have came up to raise the whole taboo issue, that is remarriage of women. Widow remarriage has become extremely popular in, and played a very important role in our in Indian society. Women are also the users of mass media. As such, they are improved and developed due to the impact of media. Of course, the media is playing a significant role in popularizing the widow remarriage along with mass media. The process of modernization, westernization and development has brought a change in mindset of people regarding the remarriage of Indian women. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Namaskar, very good morning. The title of my paper is Portrayal of Women in Television, on Television and in Films, and its role in shaping public opinion. I need not emphasize on the fact, and it is actually proven and declared, that whatever is shown in the film and on the TV, it does have an impact on people. It affects their mentality, their thought process. My point is, there is positive and negative portrayal of women in terms of their fictional characters, their apparel, their dialogues, their screen presence, you know, the amalgamation of whatever is shown on TV. So I'll try to prove it with the help of examples. Firstly, women in films and its impact on people. Negative portrayal. Now there have been movies like Grand Masti. Now something that is very bad about them is the vulgar demeaning jokes related to women and their body. The apparel which exposes the maximum skin. And there is a mentality, you know, I think sometimes that when the director does the casting, they think now the hero is set, now just take some women to add the glam quotient. Next, now these are very famous popular movies and Dil Wale Dulhaniya Le Jayenge, Hum Saath Saath Hain, Hum Aapke Hain Kaun, Maine Pyar Kiya. In all of them, the female protagonists are educated, but in the end, what do? They cook. None of them is shown. In fact, in Hum Aapke Hain Kaun, Nisha is a software engineer, but all she does is cook for Prem. Next is the way they show in the modern age cinema. Do you want to be the cool girl? I think this is the girls want to be cool and the boys consider these girls cool. So first is drink, second is dress, and the third is if you can pull off some classy attitude, you're the coolest. And if by mistake you wear a salwar kameez, you are a behenji. I think we have to move ahead of the concept that clothes define your thought process. You know, the fact that saris are, you know, considered the apparel of our country. Even if I wear jeans or shirt, it does not mean that I do not respect my culture. In fact, I believe shirt and pants cover more of your body than a sari does. So it's more of a respectable attire that a woman can wear. then the item numbers. You know, I have highlighted item. Why are they called item numbers? Are the heroines in them called the item numbers? I mean, it is a little bad. I feel appalled, you know, when I say that. But I think that is why they call item numbers. Sheila ki jawani, Munni ki badnami. That is what they're trying to highlight there. Positive portrayal. I think Queen, we are the ones who appreciated it very much. What I liked about it was the liberation. I think from the time when Rani's mother was sending her 10-year-old brother, even for a date with her. So, you know, with the perspective, you know, he is a guy, he can protect her. And then that phase of liberation that is shown, you know, when she's traveling the whole world, not being depressed by the fact that the husband left her. I think that shift from the ignorant and submissive partner to a confident and decisive partner. Then movies like Mardani, No One Killed Jessica, you know, they portrayed strength and not fragility in women. And women in posts like that of Crime Branch, which is stereotyped for men. I mean, there are hardly movies which show women as police officers. We had Drishyam recently, which showed Tabu as one of them. So I think these are quite appreciable things. Next is English in English. I think the fact I like this movie is because even my mother is not very good at English. But that has nothing to do with it. So I think English in English helps absorb the fact that not knowing English is not a taboo at all. The language you speak has nothing to do with the confidence you bear and the knowledge that you have. Also, being a housewife is itself a great job. It is something to be, you know, be proud of, because it is a business in itself that you run. I come to the Indian television industry. The stereotype and negative portrayal. Now the typical Sasbahu shows, already a lot has been spoken about it. The unnecessarily tense relationships that are shown, the excessive drama, less pragmatism, people are fighting, chaos all the time. That does not happen in families. I mean, once we go home, we just chill with our family, talk about the daily routine. That's how it is, which is definitely not shown on this. Bidai, I think this was a serial that came. In this, skin color was shown as a major criteria for beauty. And it propagated the ever-growing desire of Asians to look fair. It made clear that dark women must be prepared to accept rejection whilst the matchmaking period. Now, obviously, first, why are the women being rejected and men not being? But this has been going since ever. Now, even like, you know, if I forego that fact, how can you reject somebody on the basis of their color? It is a part, you know, it's a natural selection process. It's about the amount of melanin in your body. You can't do anything about the color, but it has nothing to do with how beautiful you are. Next is Comedy Nights with Kapil. No lies, I have laughed on the many jokes that he cracks. But also, I cannot lie about the fact that he jokes on his wife's lips, which is very sad. You know, these kind of jokes that we laugh on are supposed, these are something that we have to, you know, like, do not appreciate. The hair on Palaguti's body, I mean, these are certain things that you can't comment upon. At least you can't crack jokes on a national television. Positive portrayal again, the other side of the coin. Balika Urdu, what I liked here was, they've first shown the very realities, the nuances of women, a woman's life in villages, the things that she goes through. I think it has been very well portrayed. Second is Diyar Bati, where she's a police officer and the entire family helps her achieve this dream. That support is something to be appreciated. Next is DID Little Moms, where, you know, barring the age factor, the mothers, they get a chance to, you know, go and present your dancing skills. There is nothing like, because often we've seen that, no, I'm beginner, I cannot dance now. There is nothing like this. So the conclusion is, the reality is the fact that the bad movies and TV shows are propagators because we are the part of the audience. So the ugly truth is, we also watch that, we are a part of the audience. The challenge is, let's not watch these. Let's not, for the sake of mediocre entertainment, be attracted by these things. Let's go in for informative shows that we can be proud of. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. My topic is on women's representation in media with respect to advertisement. The media is a very powerful socializing agent, and vast amount of knowledge can be gained from studying its influence. Popular media focuses much more heavily on a whole heart of negative and limiting aspects of women, including an intense scrutiny of emphasis on their works and how they struggle so hard to balance life and work. Image is of great importance, since it is through our perception that we build up our first impression on people and instantly judge, categorize and group them. The last several decades have seen changes in the role of women in society. The representation of women in media has always been exploitative, it has throughout the years reduced women to being nothing more than an object. Also, men compare the women in their lives to have to what they see on television screens, magazines, and on billboards. Both self and society had suffered because of the objectification of women, and not only includes the state of shame and fear in women, but it also promotes the treatment of them as in humans' playthings. Thin, barely clothed bodies appear in magazines and on back of buses. Oftentimes, the women portrayed in these ads are not even whole. The picture shows only leg, torsos. This reduces women to collection of parts, something less than humans. Media are responsible for degrading of women, since advertisements are shown by are seen by the target audience of age group between 15 to 30 years and may not processed in a right manner. Whether or not these images pollute the cultural environment, however, with the media consistently flashing the idol around every corner, the likelihood of self-acceptance and a less judgmental societies down the street without fear of assault. We need some gender-neutral media policies so that we can say woman is not made, she is born. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Start my presentation with a video. It's basically an ad of Tata. This advertisement has developed a sexist notion. Forget about the grown-ups, but in the tender minds. What does it say? It's only the girls who have to change according to the situation, and boys cannot. Boys cannot even change to such an extent that he can play with dolls. So the main aim of the mass media is to be universal and suitable for everyone. And what is the responsibility of mass media that it acts as a true mirror of the society? But my question is the mass media really taking its responsibility very seriously and acting like a mirror? You spend a day watching your favorite movies, TV shows, commercials, and you'll be as stunned as I am looking at the dichotomy between what we say women are capable of doing versus what and how women are actually being depicted. The way women are shown in media these days is hardly different than those before a decade or a few. Women have been shown to consider being a homemaker as the ultimate goal of their life. From the commercial of wigs, toilet cleaners, washing powders, to the cooking masala, you'll mostly see a woman doing domestic chores. Yes, if I talk about the movies we have developed, but from what? From not showing just homemakers to showing exploitation? Their keen focus is how they are struggling to balance their work and their life. You all must have seen English for English. Did the character of Sridevi inspire you all? Not to me personally. Yes, she was shown courageous, she opted for English classes, but then what? On the final day of exam, she stepped back just to do some domestic chores in which she was perfect. Had it been a man, he couldn't make an hour out to give the exam, but Sridevi could not. But because, wo to paida hi laddu banane ke liye hui thi. Media focuses much more heavily on a whole host of negative or limiting aspects of women, including an intense scrutiny of emphasis on their looks. They are supposed to be fair, they are supposed to be extremely thin to be beautiful, not to forget the fair and lovely advertisement. Now, why do you think item songs are made part of any movie? As my friend Freksha has talked about this, my same question is that why these songs are called item songs? Item means object, and objectification of women is very common and accepted in our society. She's like a winner trophy, something one can show off. In the movies like Rowdy Rathore, Singham, Blue, Dhoom 3 and many such movies, actresses didn't have any major role in the story, but they are just put in to add a stint of glamour. Now, it's not just the women whose portrayal is limited to certain aspects that we are talking about since morning. It is the representation of men also which is not correct in the media. Mainstream media represents
also play a role in reinforcing ideas about what it means to be a real man in our society. In most media portrayals, male characters are rewarded for self-control and the control of others, aggression and violence, financial independence and physically strong. Male characters are often associated with the public sphere of work rather than the private sphere of home, and issues and problems related to work are more significant than personal issues. The media industry has tended to characterize men as a macho guys. Don't we have the men who doesn't have that much physical strength which we see on the movies or whatever the shows are telecasted on the screen? I draw your attention towards the song Gandhi Baat. The lyric says, ABCD padhli bohat, achhi baatein karli bohat, ab karunga tere saath Gandhi Baat. And what kind of Gandhi Baat he's talking about, we all know that. But what we have done, we have made it the party anthem. We all enjoy this song so well. So media education can play a crucial role in restricting the impact of this influential force. To understand that media can influence us in biased manner is very important, and this can lead to develop a society where women and men can be treated equally in both real and real life. And this sexist notion has developed to such an extent that I will give you a real life example. I asked my cousin to imagine an auntie and an uncle, and I asked him, what did you imagine about the auntie? He said, auntie ghar mein khana bana rahi hai and uncle office ja rahe hai. So you can imagine the sexist notion which has been developed in our minds. Thank you.
Thank you so much. After Richa, we have Prakriti.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Prakriti Singh, and I'll be presenting my research paper on gender stereotypes and media. Media is a mirror to society and a powerful entity of communication. A special duty is imposed on media as it acts as a fourth pillar of the democracy. Gender and media have been playing a very important role together for a very longer period of time. Gender is a range of characteristics pertaining to differentiating between masculinity and femininity based on the characters, which may include biological sex or sex based on social characters or gender roles. A man might say women aren't meant for combat. A woman might say men do nothing in their free time but watch sports. These are certain overgeneralizations which are based upon our preconceived notions. Gender stereotypes may have certain negative connotations, like women are better caregivers than men. But that is not true in all the cases. Media plays a very important role since the beginning in framing certain stereotypes from childhood. For example, like Disney movies, which teaches us certain morals and values like believing in oneself and hard work always leads to success. But then we forget to notice or fail to notice that the roles that the characters adopt here. Women are usually shown weak, helpless and waiting for the prince to save the day. Whereas on the flip side, men are shown to be more strong and independent. This automatically leads to a situation where there is a power distance between men and women. On a social level, media has a great impact. The main elements of media are usually entertainment and news. The entertainment medium usually presents certain representation that cannot be accepted at the face value, because this leads to certain unfair stereotypes which creeps in our social norms, and also a misconceived representation that also leads to thinking of generations. When it comes to unfair beauty standards being perceived by the media, usually the female who are much more attractive are accepted in the mainstream, whereas those which do not fall in this narrow bracket are painted as sidekicks. Similar standard is maintained in certain magazines or movies where certain trends are being followed by the youth aimlessly. But if they are not able to keep in pace with the changing trends, it automatically leads to crisis in one's own gender identity or lowering of self-esteem. Media has fixed role of men and women. Men are supposed to be much more stronger and are not supposed to show their emotions, whereas women are supposed to dress gracefully and show a vulnerability in them, so it automatically shows them as a submissive towards the male dominance. Though media and commercials have been related to each other, they have objectified women sexually in various advertisements related to deodorants and perfumes. Commercials today also target certain gender roles that sell their product. For example, products related to hard drinks or alcohol usually target masculinity to sell their products. This leads to certain altering of perception of men and women, and it tells us how should we look upon them in the society. Not only certain advertisements related to adults but also children also. For example, the Barbie commercial, which shows little girls dressed in soft pastel colored dresses showing their sweetness and softness. But we cannot ignore the fact that these images which are formed are not saccharine images. Same thing goes for the boys, where certain muscular toys are shown, where the narrator or the voiceover in that 30 second ad usually have a voice very dominating, aggressive, and pinpoints that men are more aggressive and men are more active than women. Most of the society believes women are physically weaker sex and men are usually emotionally weaker sex. But yes, the fact is true that men are much stronger than women, but we cannot also ignore the fact that females can also stand against the will of an against the men. Trends have been changing since then and media has developed positively. Women are now shown in a much stronger roles, for example, in the Matrix franchise or Angelina Jolie starring movies. And we also see men playing a very emotional role, for example, in the revolutionary role, a role played by Leonardo DiCaprio and Kevin Spacey in American Beauty. We cannot accept that fact that these two different gender have been playing opposite roles in the society. I think it's time that we take a look at what messages we are sending in a society. It should be that it's okay to bring to accept that men can also show their emotions and women are not always sexually objectified. We don't want our future generation to be a part that shows a vicious cycle of gender differentiation and that promotes gender indifferences. In the last, I would like to quote Emma Watson's speech during her UN Cause for Women topic, in which she said, it's time that we all see all spectrums of gender rather than seeing them as ideals of certain opposing two sets. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Next, I would like to...
Good morning, the one and all present here. Today my topic for the presentation is media and gender representations. Gender is perhaps the basic category we use for certain human beings, and it is a key issue when discussing representations. Media and gender representations refers to the influence of media on gender identification. The media creates representations that gives a particular picture or model of someone or something. Since ages, the women is being considered as the weaker section of our society. Until now, the notion is same. As the technology is developed,
Tripti, just for a second, I would like to make an announcement that we have just two more speakers. Let us all listen to her and not move in and out of the room because it is very disturbing and not good. Doesn't give a good message even to the speakers. Can we just sit quietly for another 5-10 minutes and hear what Tripti has to say? Yes, Tripti, continue.
As the technology has developed, the media has came into the force. Many incidents took place against the women, but still there is something in this patriarchal society which do not let women stand for their rights, nor they get an equal opportunity as men can. It is undeniable that the media shapes our conceptions of what it means to be male or female, yet media representations of women remain worryingly constant. Does this reflect that the status of women has not really changed, or that the male-dominated media does not want to accept that it has changed? The representations of women across all media tend to highlight the following: beauty, size and physics, sexuality, emotional as opposed to intellectual, dating relationships as opposed to independence, freedom. Discussion of women's representations in the media tend to revolve around the focus on physical beauty to the near exclusion of their other values, the lack of powerful female role models, and the extremely artificial nature of such portrayals, which bear little or no relation to the reality experienced by women across the planet. It would take almost a whole O-level course to cover the representations and the issues surrounding them in depth. Talking about the media is talking about a mission. a source of information and education that will shape the daily choices in people's life, that will shape the thinking and the perception of things. But media is a political power and tool occupied in a way by the big powers, international corporations, big agencies, using for their political and economic objectives that control and pay. By the development and advancement in the technology, the world has shrunken into a global village. There is a small number of such kind of news which should bring something valuable to people and bring a positive effect on them. The role and the mission of the media is to commit itself to values that are imperative for today. And it is possible to achieve these goals only if civil societies commit themselves into risks and understand the need for it and encourages agencies that can play this role. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Sriti. We now move to the last speaker, Srishti.
Topic, social media and celebrity. As we all know about, we are interrelated to social media and celebrity. We are can't live without social media, as we all know, and we get bored. We see just a nice picture of Ranbir Kapoor and any other actor, we just feel nice. This is everything. How celebrities use social media. The fans get information and media about each moment of their favorite stars through social media. Twitter, we know about where is Ranbir Kapoor, where is Vin Diesel, where is Paul Walker. We know everything about Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. We follow very nicely. As we can see, top actor on social media is Vin Diesel. He got 72 million likes, 54 million likes after the death of his good friend Paul Walker in a car crash accident. As we can see, Bollywood stars Shah Rukh Khan, Amitabh Bachchan. The mega star Amitabh Bachchan is an active social media user. We care about Aradhya Bachchan. We are eagerly waiting for Aradhya Bachchan. There is a long queue after the hospital, I guess Neelavati Hospital. There is a long queue for Aradhya's one picture. We don't care about who is the neighbor of our society. The next is Shah Rukh Khan, the King Khan of the Bollywood star. We care about Abraham Khan. We don't care about anyone. We follow Abraham Khan. He is, I guess, 1 year. But we eagerly waiting for that. 14.6 million of Shah Rukh Khan. Online properties can engage. How movies are like online. YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, and etc. We know about Tamasha is coming in 2015. We know it about in 2012. But we don't know about anything in politics and how celebrities use social media to promote a cause or charity. I especially mention an example of Hollywood star like a car crash accident like Britney Spears came. They promote a charity for a crash case family. The family has 5 person and both parents were killed and 2 children become paralyzed. They got a very good charity through promoting a social media. The end of a Hollywood and the rise of social media celebrity. There are some celebrities in YouTube, those who became famous, as we can see, there are some YouTube platformers who became very famous. They got a very good millions like in very recently, and there are most of the actors on Hollywood, nobody knows about them. How social media has changed what it means it to be a celebrity. I'm sorry. In 1990s, there takes a lot of time to become a celebrity, but now just post a your video or a picture on Instagram, Vine, Facebook, Twitter, you get a celebrity in some hours. Changing face-to-face social media celebrity is just the same. A 6-second video from Justin Bieber is like a million likes right now. He's the very famous of that actor, that video in Vine. End of thing, the social media and the celebrity. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Srishti, and thank you all for wanting to go. One is this, I think Preksha mentioned about English and saying that my mother does not know English, but it's okay, I don't feel so embarrassed. We have to understand our history when we are talking of a lot of these issues. I remember school mein humko lagta tha history ka kya, what is the significance and the relevance of history? But history is very important to actually contextualize yourself and understand today. we have to understand that our obsession with English is with our colonial past. And I tell you one very small incident that happened recently. I had gone to one particular place in Mumbai, and there were two people who were buying something, and one girl was in one corner of a very posh shop. You remember Kala Ghoda festival hota hai Bombay mein? In the Kala Ghoda festival, this girl was in one corner and the other girl, college going girl, was here. And that girl was asking, "Dekhna, is this okay? Is the color fine?" And one foreigner was standing there, and he asked that, "Are they Indians?" So I said, "Yes." "Then why are they talking in English?" I mean, it was something that did not get into his head. Ki tum dono, ye dono Bharati hai, dono ko Hindi aati hai, ye Angrezi mein kyun baat kar rahe? And we, that is something that we really don't think about it. Hum log jaate hain dukaan mein and aapas mein hum log, we would like to talk in English. Sometimes it's okay because we want to, it's also important to learn when we are academically oriented that we want to learn some terminology. But hum bahar jaate hain shopping ke liye, toh hum aapas mein bhi English mein baat karte hain. It's because of our colonial past. Another thing what I want to, everybody's presentation was really very good and they picked up from daily life, and that's why it was very interesting to see how, you know, daily we keep looking at these things and we react to the same way, but nothing moves ahead. One important thing is we all would love to believe that the mass media today or the media today is independent, is progressive, is objective, it's balanced. But please understand this one thing: freedom of press belongs to the person who owns it. So it's freedom of press is not for all. We have to understand that because of its aesthetic value, we forget that media and mass media is a very big business and owned by corporate world. And you get to see what they want you to see. You think about things that they want you to think. We don't think something, we don't have that independence. In our democracy, it is very important for the mass media to actually bring forth the truth before us, but it is never like that. We feel that the media wants to educate us. Maybe the media just wants a lot of uninformed audiences making irrational choices. So we have to keep that in mind and we have to be critical about what we see. And sometimes we must question ourselves that one issue happens in Delhi. I'm not undermining the importance of the media telling us it is about Nirbhaya. I also felt that why should you hide that name Nirbhaya? If she's a hero, why do you need to hide that name? Aap uska naam kyun nahi batate ho? It means somewhere we are also saying that ye naam batane se tumhari aur tumhare parivar ki badnaami hogi. And it happened with me when I was stripped in prison and everybody wanted to give some kind of a code over it, and I said, damn it, I don't want to hide it. Whatever happened, happened to me, and let the world know. So I feel another thing is that once it happens in Delhi, the media takes it to a level, but when it happens to Soni Sori in judicial custody, none of the press thought it was important enough to raise that issue. Why this disparity? So who is deciding? We have to question all this. I think it is time that we not give the right answers, but we ask the right questions and seek for the answers from the people. Thank you very much for this session, and we will take a tea break and come back. Thank you so much.
With this, we come to the end of the session. I now request Professor Aarti, convener of the conference, to present our chairperson and speakers of the session with mementos as taken as token of our love and gratitude. Challenges organized on 2nd and 3rd October 2015. The theme of the session is Role of Media in Shaping Public Opinion. The chairperson for the session is Professor K. L. Sharma, Institute of Development Studies, Jaipur. The speakers for the session are Professor Shamim Modi, Tata Institute of Social Sciences, Mumbai, and Professor Narayan Bare, Haridev Joshi University of Journalism and Mass Communication, Jaipur. For being a teacher, outstanding merit in 2003, he was awarded Swami Parnam Anand Saraswati in 2002 by the UGC New Delhi. The Devang Mehta Business School Award, November 26, 2011 for outstanding contribution to education by the B School Affair, Mumbai. The Lifetime Achievement Award in 2012 by the Indian Sociological Society, New Delhi. The Best Citizens of India Award 2012 by the International Publishing House, New Delhi. The National Education Leadership Award 2013 for outstanding contribution to education by the B School Affair, Mumbai. We are privileged to have Professor K. L. Sharma amongst us. We welcome you, sir. Our first speaker is Professor Shamim Modi. Professor Shamim Modi has been working as a faculty with the Tata Institute of Social Sciences in the Nodal Center of Excellence for Human Rights Education since 2009. She has worked extensively for the disadvantaged population by working for the rights of the people displaced by the Burgi Dam at Jabalpur. She has been the founder member of the Shramik Adivasi Sangathan for the last 18 years. The Sangathan has been involved with empowering the laborers working in various agriculture produce marketing societies and has endeavored to improve the condition of laborers. She has also been the member of the Working Group on Empowerment of Scheduled Tribe in the 11th Five-Year Plan of Central Government. We are privileged to have Professor Modi amongst us. We welcome you, ma'am. Our second speaker for the session is Professor Narayan Bare, Head Media Studies, Haridev Joshi University of Journalism and Mass Communication. Professor Barit has a long stint in reputed mainstream media houses. He was the state correspondent with the Asian Age and Deccan Chronicle from 2005 to 2013. He has worked with BBC for 15 years as the correspondent for Rajasthan. He has been the editorial consultant with Daily Bhaskar, principal correspondent for the Hindi edition of Outlook, correspondent for the Pioneer Jaipur, and the senior reporter with the Nav Bharat Times, Kota, Jodhpur and Jaipur. We are privileged to have Professor Barik amongst us. We welcome you, sir. I now invite Dr. R.T. Sharma to introduce the session.
Namaskar. They are asserted by individuals, collectively contemplated and weeded out in conversations among citizens. Habermas, who builds on Gabriel Tarde's notion, conceives of public opinion as resulting from rational deliberations, not limited by power relationships that would constrain free expression. Public opinion can thus be seen as either superficial and fluctuating or as deep-seated and slow to change. It relates to either public mood and irrational feelings or to a more structured and reasoned collective opinion. The development of public opinion is thought to be dependent upon the advancement of communication technologies, technological advancement of the medium of expression, from print media to electronic media, and finally to digital media, has marked milestones in the ways public spheres are conceived and advocated in each instance. Media has thus become the most powerful tool in the contemporary times. People look up to the mass media for direction and see as a medium to determine what is right and what should be seen as wrong. It also helps to mirror the socio-cultural activities of the society and how these activities affect the various social areas such as economy, polity, education, culture, and social values. In the light of the above, it becomes imperative to study the influence of mass media on public opinion. The current session focuses on the impact of media in shaping public beliefs and attitudes and its relationship to social change. I now request Professor Chairperson, Professor K.L. Sharma, to take over the proceedings of the session. Thank you.
Thank you. Friends, we have hardly lived more than 1 hour, and there are two resource persons, 14 presenters, and additionally I would also like to speak at the end. So we have 17 presentations in a way. Now I request Professor Amin Modi, Samin Modi, to take about 7 to 8 minutes, and the same Professor Bharat. So 15 minutes for two resource persons, and I think 3 minutes each for 14 speakers, and 5 to 7 minutes for me to conclude the session. This is the arrangement, and I think self-discipline would be the most desirable in such a situation. But anyway, I'll also issue warnings if required. Thank you. Professor Amin.